Delaware Lackawanna number 211 is an RS-32 that was built in 1962 for the Southern Pacific as the 7302 and later became Southern Pacific 7002. It toiled for three other owners before coming to the Genesee Valley system. It's shown here on September 18, 2017, fresh out of long-term restoration and rebuilding, along with another almost as fresh rebuild in the form of C-425 number 2457. Eleven days later, the two are still coupled together when the 211 and three other Alcos experience the ugly side of railroading when the 211, the 1554, the 2403, and the 1804 hit the ground on the north leg of the Steamtown Y, damaging all four diesels and destroying the track and ties. It would take 11 days to clean up the mess from start to finish. This is day one of that process.
What's up, rail fans? We're here at the Steamtown Y derailment site. We're going to do a quick walk around, see just how bad the damage was that was done yesterday around 3:30 p.m.
And although an unpleasant aspect of the business, railroad derailments happen a lot more often than you might have realized. There are many factors that can contribute to a train derailment, and I don't know what factors were in this one. What I do know is that when documenting this derailment, we're kind of going back and forth in time, as it's now September 30, 2017, the day after the mishap, which happened on September 29. In Volume 1 of this series, we saw the Train 11Z move past the disabled units. That was on October 2nd. What I didn't have a chance to talk about were some of the interesting little nuggets that made up its consist. For starters, let's talk about the second locomotive, number 9666. The 9666 is a -9 44CW that was built and placed in service in March of 2001 as a -9 40CW. It's part of a 160-unit order that, at the time, was the largest locomotive order on the NS since the merger of 1982. But the reason that I bring up this particular engine is because we've seen it twice before. It was 3 of 3 on Unit Grain Train 48Q that roared through Steamtown in the summer of 2018, and we caught it again down on the Pittsburgh line at Cove with the Unit Coal Train in tow. The catch of the day for me were the two J.M. Huber Kalin covered hoppers. Kalin cars like these, as well as tank cars, made up the bulk of entire CP trains back in the 1990s before the internet cut so heavily into the printed media business. Kalin is a type of clay that's used in the papermaking business, and catching these JMHX cars are extremely hard today, at least in this area. Our next train is the 37T that came up the day before the derailment. You'll learn why I'm including this train later in the series.
see there how the axle, or how the rail has just been bent right over, just warped. It's even worse as you get further down.
Here's another Train 37T along with the CSX Tier 4 Gevo and an SD70 ACE trailer.
It's just sitting on the side of the rail. The rail is just twisted right over. Same thing here on locomotive 2403.
3 days later, on October 3rd, train 14R squeezed through northbound with a massive 6-unit lash-up. Turn up the volume on this one. The Gevo sound great working up the grade.
211 had only been back in service for about a week and a half, maybe 2 weeks at the most.
Train 36T came down the line, and check out the old school Gunderson well cards from the 80s and 90s. A couple of months ago, a viewer asked me in a comment about the CSX C-Land double stack trains that used to run over the Susquehanna Railroad. I have limited knowledge of those trains, but I'll share what I do know in a separate video.
Look at how that rail's twisted over. In all, there were 5 locomotives that were in this consist. The lead unit, which was 2457, has already since been detached. This happened yesterday. And is, well, wherever he's at, we now have 4 locomotives still here, a total of 6 trucks laying on the ground. As you can see, the damage on this side is a lot worse than on the other side.
Later that evening, train 14R did its thing with some colorful foreign power in the form of BNSF and Union Pacific GEs. Thank you. Down at Taylor Yard that same evening, the day's train 10A moved south on its nightly jaunt to Northumberland. Note the black number boards on the Gevo 8167.
Why don't someone tell me next year rail work on it?
Even later still, the K-82 was rustling about working the American rock salt spur in the twilight's last gleaming. The number boards on the nose of the leading GE is an easy identifier of its former Conrail heritage. Those EMP containers on the siding will be picked up by the northbound train 11A shortly after. The train approaching us is the Enola-bound 11Z, but the crew navigating this land barge is the K-81 out of Taylor Yard. Also, we're not rail fanning early in the morning as would normally be the case for this train. It's now almost 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I never got the full story, but from what I was able to retrieve from the radio, a broken knuckle or some other mishap disabled the 11Z while coming down the 10-mile slide into Taylor. The actual 11Z crew outlawed while trying to fix the issue. In the meanwhile, the K-81 crew out of Taylor recovered the disabled train and brought the Taylor freight, including the intermodals, down separately and then went back up to get the rest of the train. Down at Taylor, train M4R, which is a 14R extra train, is waiting to come up the hill.
Thank you. Thank you.